presence of the Holy Spirit in our place today. If this is your first time worshiping with us, we especially want to reach out to you. Thank you for being here and delighted that we have a chance to have a glimpse into this wonderful, wonderful congregation. Where we join together and worship the Lord each week. Here are a few announcements. Thank you to everybody who came yesterday to help us in our church-wide cleanup. Please join us this evening at 6 p.m. as we kick off the season with the lighting of the Christmas tree. Hear the music of the choir. Sing your favorite Christmas carols. This will be a great opportunity for us to shine our light into the community. A special offering will be taken for the United Methodist Children's Church. Our annual Christmas dinner will be next Sunday, December 14th at 6 p.m. The men of the church will cook turkeys, and all other members will bring a side dish. And I just have to ask, because I think it makes a difference, which men?
Nobody wants to come.
No, I think, Dick, are you the turkey man?
No.
Phil. Phil, are you the turkey? He's a military man. I would trust him to make my turkey. Blessed are the turkey makers. They shall inherit the side dish. All right. So please come. It's going to be good. If Phil's involved in any way, I'm sure it's going to be ship-shaped. So please invite your neighbors and your family and your friends for a fun-filled evening. Please note the second Sunday lunch is canceled because we have that wonderful dinner coming up next week. If you would like to purchase a poinsettia to honor someone special or in remembrance of someone special, please speak to Lillian Barber. The cost is $9, and you'll get to take it home after the Christmas Eve service. Thank you. The greeter's announcement. It's time again to review and approve the greeter's list for the next 6 months. This is a really, really important job because it's the first impression that our congregation makes on people. It makes all the difference in the world that when someone new arrives, or even someone who's returning arrives, there's someone there to smile and give them a hug. Marie Given has asked me to have everyone look over the previous list, and they're on the back page of it, to make sure to verify that the date you're signed up for you can do. If you can't do that date, just scratch through it. And Marie's then going to type up a list, a new and improved list, for each, and that each of you will get a copy for the coming year, and knowing the specific date that you were assigned to be the greeter. Finally, the Recycle Hut is a Girl Scout Silver Award project built by Abigail Heron in 2014. The Recycle Hut is a place where used laser printer and inkjet cartridges can be deposited for recycling. Then they are taken to an office supply store where they can either be exchanged for money or store credit or more office supplies. The Recycle Hut will benefit Christ United Methodist Church by helping to provide more office supplies for the church office when the cartridges are exchanged. Everyone is encouraged to recycle and deposit their used printer cartridges there, where it will help the church instead of adding to the waste in the landfill. Please help our church and reduce waste by recycling your used printer cartridges here. Where is it again?
It's downstairs. You come in the front door, you make a left, when you go down the hallway.
Okay, so it's on the left as you come in through the front door. That's a great thing. Thank you, Girl Scout. Please check the back table for more information on current events and hard copies of prize cards. Please remember to turn off your cell phones. Thank you. Reverend Nancy.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It is wonderful to see all of you here this morning on the second Sunday of the season of Advent. It is a wonderful season and a great day to be in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And it's great to see all of you here to worship with us together. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Shall we pray? Loving God, on the second Sunday of this season, we wait for your coming. We watch to see you as you arrive in our midst, and we thank you because we know that you are really here already in our hearts and in our community. even as we pray. Lord, we thank you for this time of worship. We thank you for this place where we can come together in fellowship and remember, God, all of your good gifts. So be with us in this hour. Speak to us, whisper into our ears, our hearts, and our minds, so that we may see you and hear you and know you better, and so that we may carry you as a light into our communities. For we pray all of this in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Exodus 2:18. It came upon the midnight clear. Our second hymn of praise is 2:17, Away in the Manger. Remember, at this time is when you may turn in your prayer cards. The ushers will be around for during both hymns. Please stand as you are able. 2:18.
Yeah. Let us pray. Savior of the world, kindle the hope you have placed in our hearts.
Instill in us a confidence and expectation in your coming, your presence, and your future reign. Teach us how we can bring hope to the world. Amen.
Please turn to number 881 in your hymnals for the affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed traditional version. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and stood at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. This is Psalm 89, verses 1 through 8. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I will make your faithfulness known to all the generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you established your faithfulness in heaven itself. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen. I have sworn to David my servant, I will establish your line forever and make your throne firm through all generations. The heavens praise your wonders, O Lord, your faithfulness to them. In the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He is more awesome than all surrounding. O Lord God Almighty, who is like you? You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds.
Take just a brief moment to talk a little bit about our service tonight and the special offering that we will be taking up. I think all of you have got bulletin, will have gotten this brochure in your bulletin. Would you pull that out for us, Christina, and I want you to take a look at it. I want to ask you to make sure that you read this, that you take it home with you. This is for the United Methodist Children's Home, and many of you already know all about what that's about. Some may not. But the United Methodist Children's Home is a large organization. It exists here in the United Methodist Church in the North Georgia Conference in several places. Its main campus is in Decatur, where they have a residential program for older children. They have several offices throughout North Georgia. One is in Gainesville, where Todd and I interact a lot, because many of you know that we recently had foster children in our home, and it was the United Methodist Children's Home that made that possible. They gave us our training, they supported us, they gave us the placement of the child, and did all of the necessary work to make sure we had what we need to take care of those children well. Now, children are important to us all throughout the year, but I think we especially think of them right now at Christmas, as we approach Christmas and as we celebrate Advent. And so I want you to do two things. I want you to come to the tree lighting service tonight, and I want you to consider giving generously to the United Methodist Children's Home for the wonderful work that they do for the children among us who need it the most. Will you do that? If you will, say amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, at this time, then, I would like to invite all of our children to come forward for their special time in our worship service. Come on down, take her over this way.
And of course, the things that the kids always worry about when I have a box. Chucky! Oh, Chucky! Hello! Chucky's George.
Oh, no!
Oh, yes, come on, get out of here. Hello! Wait, what? Hello? Well,
you're
Merry Christmas. Okay, guys. I have to ask questions of the children. Oh, you're not a child. It's a heresy. Okay, guys. In like a couple weeks, something big happens. What happens in a couple weeks?
Christmas.
We're all in agreement. Christmas, right? What had to happen about 9 months before Christmas? Well, Mary's
birth. No,
9 months before, because Jesus' birth is Christmas. So 9 months before.
No, Jesus' birth is
Mary being pregnant. Right. Okay. Now, Reverend Nancy is going to teach you today the scripture. Well, I don't know that word. Reverend Nancy is teaching scripture about the angel coming to Mary and saying, "Hail!" And by the way, I'm going to get you pregnant. Or you're going to be pregnant by the Holy Spirit. But you guys don't worry about it just yet. But anyway, now, you know, this is like really blowing my mind. I was thinking about this. What if God came to me and said, "George, I'm going to make you pregnant." What?
George!
Yeah?
You know what you just said?
Well, I said, what if God came to me and said, "I'm going to make you pregnant"?
That's impossible! You'd make others mother and say it! Because I said you're a man, you can't get pregnant!
Okay. God came to Mary and said, "I'm going to give you a baby." And Mary said, "Oh, okay." Well, more or less. She said kind of pretty. But more. But what that means is Mary trusted God. Chucky, you trust me?
No.
Why not?
You're weird.
I'm weird. Okay. Trust.
Beware the bot.
Okay, it's all about trust. Do you guys trust God?
Yes.
You trust me?
Yes.
You do? You do?
No.
Okay, wait. If you trust in God, wonderful things will happen. If you don't trust in God, nothing happens. You have to trust. Now, the test today is if you reach into the box, maybe, just maybe, something wonderful will happen. I don't trust you. Reverend Nancy, do you trust me?
All right.
Uh-oh. Okay, hang on, here we go.
Reverend Nancy, watch out!
Got you yet? Provided the courage. inspiration for all of us to trust in something that is pretty hard. So it's about trust, you guys, and the wonderful things that God can give us. Okay, Oliver, get back to me. You know what you're doing. Okay, group hug.
Who comes to dwell among us. We watch for your coming in this holy season. As we light candles and sing songs celebrating your advent, we look for your arrival and listen for your call. Lord, we hear the story about your call to Mary, about the angel Gabriel and the favored one. The Mother of Jesus. We know that your call to us is not so very different. We know that we may not be called to have a child, to be the mother of the Savior of everyone, but we are called to bear the Christ into a waiting and weary world. As I'm sure Mary must have felt, Lord, sometimes this task seems too much for us. God, we may be overwhelmed by the hurt that is in our world, and we wonder what on earth we poor individuals can do. Lord, sometimes we feel exhausted by the responsibilities that weigh on us already, and we can't imagine how we could possibly do any more. Comfort us, Holy Giver. Remind us that you are our strength, our endurance. You are the one who makes all things possible, even a baby born in a manger, to be the Savior of the world. Remind us that when we say yes to your bidding, we reach the very heart of our own being here in this world, and we touch the divine. Touch our hearts, O Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Breathe your Spirit into us so that at your call, we too may rise and follow. Lord, we pray on this day for the many who are on our homes, for those who are not here because of sickness, because of other things. Lord, we pray for Jim, for Todd, for Vivian, for Roland, for all of those who would like to be here but are not able to. We pray for Nancy. We pray for each person who needs your special care in this time. May they feel your love, and may they feel it through us, experiencing the love of their family. And remind us, Lord, of the bonds between us that call us to be the family you created. For we pray all of this in the name of that one, that baby born in the manger, the one for whom we wait, who grew up to heal us and feed us and teach us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
Thank you.
And I invite you to stand as you're ready for the reading of God's word. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. They dispensed with all the usual introductions. The angel, Gabriel, seemed to know already who Mary was, and she seemed to at least know what an angel looked like if she didn't know this one by name. To hear them talk, you would have thought that they were old friends. Gabriel even had a special name for Mary that he seemed to think was more important than the name that her parents had given her. He greeted her with the words, "Greetings, favored one." Greetings, favored one. In fact, twice during their conversation, he calls her favored, favored by God. And from Mary's question, we get the idea that she's not so sure exactly what this whole favors thing is all about. And I'm not so sure that we get it either. In our modern times, we may think of ourselves as favored by God, receiving God's blessings. Most of us would consider ourselves a blessed people, and we should. We receive multiple blessings from God. We receive overwhelming, abundant gifts from our Lord. Here we are just rolling off of Thanksgiving, a time when we set aside to remember all of the ways that we are blessed, all of the things that we receive from God, and to give thanks, to acknowledge that we are blessed, that we are favored. But when we think about being favored or being blessed by God, and I'm sure we define that in a number of ways, I'm not sure how many of them stack up to Mary's story. This is a beautiful Christmas song that probably most of you have heard, called "Mary, Did You Know?" And it asks essentially, "Did you know that your son Jesus was the Savior?" And before that, I have to wonder, did she know, did she have any idea that anything significant would be made of her life? Scripture tells us that she came from a town in Galilee called Nazareth. Later on in the gospel, someone will ask, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Nazareth was nowhere. In fact, it is nowhere. It doesn't even exist in ruins today. If you were to take a trip to the Holy Land today, that wouldn't be a stop that you would make, because it isn't there. Only a rough idea of where it used to be. Now, one source I read said that Nazareth was known for its jealous and materially minded people, but for the most part, it wasn't known at all. It isn't mentioned in the Old Testament, in the rabbinic writings, or any of the historical materials. And in the introduction, this introduction to the Gospel of Luke, as they are talking about Jesus coming from Nazareth, we might as well be hearing that a prophet is going to come from New Harley, Georgia, or Hepzibah, or Swan. Now, over the Thanksgiving break, Todd and I celebrated Thanksgiving with his family, with his extended family, and a lot of people were gathered there, including some family that we had never met before. Todd's nephew's wife invited her mother to come and join us, and we got to greet her and got to know her a little bit, and I asked her where she was from, and she said, "I live outside Athens in this little town you've probably never heard of called Colbert, Georgia." You may have ever heard of Colbert, Georgia. Some of you have. Well, I have to admit, I have not. And as we were talking about it, she told me that one day she got a call from her doctor's office, and the guy on the other end of the line said, "Hello, I'm calling from the Colbert Medical Center." And she said, "I know what TV show you've been watching." Because it's not Colbert, it's just Colbert. And it's a place that not a lot of people know where it is. Not a lot of people knew where Nazareth was. Nobody cared where it was. Mary is a girl that nobody has heard of, from a place that nobody has heard of. Could she possibly have known the kind of future that awaited her, or the difference that her life was going to make? I wonder if Mary knew how hard it was going to be just being a mother at all, never mind being the mother of Jesus. A few years ago, I was reading Barbara Kingsolver's book, High Tide in Tucson, and she talks about motherhood, saying people will claim that having children is a ticket to immortality. But in fact, it merely doubles your stakes in mortality. You labor and you love, and there you are with twice as many eyes that can be put out, hearts that can be broken, new lives dearer to you than your own that can be taken from you. And still we do it. Many of you guys are parents, and you probably know that the hardest thing about being a parent versus not being a parent is that now there are other people in the world whose hurts will be more painful to you than your own.